Okay, so with chapter 4, we continue the big part in our lecture on advanced graph algorithms. This time we start from a very simple algorithm that you have also learned about in algorithms 1, namely DFS, depth first search. But now we will use it in a fairly advanced way. And that's basically meant as demonstrating the power of the approach of depth-first search and how a basically simple algorithm can be non-trivial if you apply it to not-so-trivial problems. So let's recall, what was this DFS schema we considered in algorithms 1? So basically, DFS is a systematic way to explore all nodes in a graph, and you can collect information on the way. And we will make use of this. So the schema works like this. First, all nodes are unmarked, and we call a generic routine init that initializes all the data that we need. Then, in turn, each vertex is considered, and if it's not marked, a depth-first search from this node is started. This is done by first marking this node, and then calling the generic function root, and then calling a recursive function DFS. The function DFS has two parameters. one is the node the search came from, and the other is the node V, that is visited now. And you see that we have this special case that a root in this DFS tree comes from itself because there's nothing leading there. Now from this node V, all outgoing edges are expected. And now there are two main cases. If the reached node W is already marked, then this is a so-called non-tree edge, and we call a generic function traverse non-tree edge. Otherwise, it's a tree edge. W is marked, and a recursive call on W is done. When all the edges have been inspected, a backtrack is performed, going back from V back to U. Now, the point is, by defining these functions init, root, traverse non-tree edge, traverse tree edge, and backtrack, DFS can do a large spectrum of different things. And we will need some of these very simple things that you may have seen already in algorithms 1, which I will now quickly review. So the first thing is a DFS ordering, where we have scalar value DFS POS, which is the current position. So the idea is that we are numbering the nodes, and DFS POS is the current number. And then there's an array DFS num that initially is undefined. In root, we are setting the DFS num of the new root to this current position. And similarly, we do the same thing in traverse tree edge. And since we will use the ordering induced by DFS num very frequently in the subsequent discussion, we introduce this comparison operation, let's call it less. So U is less than V if DFS num U is less than DFS num V. So let's look at an example. This graph has only a single root. The DFS num is initialized to 1 and S gets this value. Then we explore a tree edge to B, which gets number 2. tree edge to E, number 3, tree edge to G, which gets the number 4. And then there's a non-tree edge going back to B, which is already marked, and there nothing happens. Then there's a tree edge to F, which gets the number 5. Then there are backtrack operations. Then there's another tree edge to C, which gets the number 6, more backtracks, more non-tree edges. Here you see different kinds of non-tree edges, which are called cross edges, which go to pieces of this DFS tree that were already explored. Okay. A different ordering we can define is the so-called finishing time, where which is set when we recurse on a when we backtrack on a tree edge. And we see that for this graph it's the same as before. We do lots of things before anything happens, because the tree edge or root operations do nothing. But then there's a first backtrack operation that sets the finishing time to 1. So F is the first finished node, meaning that we have done everything we will ever do with it. We backtrack again to G. Then we go here, but E has yet another edge to explore, so it goes here, and then we backtrack on this edge, so C gets the 3, then E is finished, gets the number 4, B is a 5, S still can explore this edge, then D gets a 6, and S is a 7. So basically we have two numberings of nodes. So somehow the DFS ordering tells us when DFS starts processing a node, and the finishing time tells us when it finishes. And by combining these two numbers, we can find out a lot of things about the status of the search. So we will now use this information and other techniques to find strongly connected components. So consider the following relation, left, right, star, or however we should call it, or let's call it strongly connected. We say two vertices U and V are strongly connected if there's a path from U to V and a path from V to U. So this is particularly relevant for directed graphs. In undirected graphs, these two notions are equivalent, right? And then we simply talk about connectedness. Strongly connectedness is a more complicated thing, as you may imagine. For example, in this graph, we can go from F to I, but not backwards, right? In contrast, these three vertices, they are arranged in a circle, and they can reach each other, although they are not direct edges between any pair of them, right? So a nice exercise you could do if you want to learn more about this is one can easily show that the strongly connected relation is an equivalence relation, meaning every vertex is strongly connected to itself, and we have a transitivity. Yes, and if U is equivalent to V, then V is equivalent to U. Okay, let's look at an example. This graph here, you can easily verify that the nodes C, D, F, G, and H, basically this blob here, they are strongly connected to each other. Whereas all the other nodes form trivial equivalence classes. They are only equivalent, strongly connected to themselves. What we can also see here is that the graph you get when you contract equivalence classes, is a directed acyclic graph. And that's one of the important reasons why we look at strongly connected components. We can somehow break down a lot of graph problems into two separate things. One, to handle equivalence relations, equivalence classes, so sets of nodes that are reachable from each other. And one, the core structure of the graph, a directed acyclic graph of equivalence classes, and then we can, for example, process equivalence classes in topological order. That's another notion that's related and that was already solved by DFS in the algorithms one lecture. So how do we compute strongly connected components? There's a bunch of algorithms out there, most of them using DFS in some way or the other. But we will start with a more abstract view, actually. We will start out with a graph that only contains node but no edges. And then we add the edges of our input graph, one edge by the other. And we somehow maintain the invariant that we know the strongly connected components of this graph GC at any point in time. We will make use of the fact that we can add the edges in any order we want, and we will pick a clever order so that maintaining the invariant is easy. So that's a very high-level idea of the algorithm. Doesn't disclose a lot of things yet. Besides this component graph GC, we will also work with a shrunken version of it, GCS, whose nodes are the strongly connected components of GC, and whose edges basically express the edges that are available in GC. And so basically this makes more concrete our claim that we know the equivalence classes and the strongly connected components of GC. Namely, we know it's strongly connected components and how they are connected in an acyclic graph. So what are the effects of a new edge on the component graph and its shrunken version? If an edge is within a strongly connected component of GC, nothing changes. If it's an edge between two strongly connected components, there are two cases. Either if no cycle is closed in GCS, then it's simply a new edge in GCS. If a cycle is closed, all the strongly connected components on that cycle collapse. For example, suppose we have this graph here except this red edge. So it contains this strongly connected component and this strongly connected component and an edge here. Now, if we look at this edge, well, so we would, this would previously be isolated, then we would simply add an edge to GC and GCS. But if we look at this edge, then we see, okay, there's an edge from this component to that component, and an edge from this component to that component. So we close this cycle, meaning that these two strongly connected components are merged into a single large strongly connected component. So getting a bit more concrete, we will use DFS to find strongly connected components. We use an approach independently discovered by Sherian and Mehlhorn in 96 and by Gabo in 2000. The vertices in the component graph are the marked nodes of the DFS, and the edges in the component graph are those that have so far been explored by the DFS. And we have active nodes. Those are nodes that are already marked, but not yet finished. Finished in the meaning of when we compute finishing times, right? So node is finished when the finishing time has been computed. And it's marked when it's marked in the DFS. So what are the strongly connected components of this component graph? They are somehow in part implicitly defined, and in part we know something explicit. And at the end, everything should be explicit. So, and of course, initially you haven't done a lot of stuff. Nodes that are not reached somehow implicitly define trivial connected components, single node, and those are all the unmarked nodes define these trivial connected components, strongly connected components. Then a strongly connected component of GC is called open if it contains any active nodes, and it's called closed if all its nodes are finished. And for the closed components, we want that the array component W, indexed by a vertex ID, is a representative of a strongly connected component. So for each strongly connected component, we designate one vertex ID that represents the strongly connected component, and all the vertices in this component store the same value in this component array. Yeah, and then there are the open components can contain nodes, and they are also called open nodes. And similarly, nodes in closed components are called closed. And in order to understand and design this algorithm, we will need several invariants for the component graph. Namely, edges from closed nodes lead to closed nodes. Open components can be numbered from 1 to k, such they form a path in the shrunken component graph, and they are connected basically in a linked list. And the representatives will actually be the first nodes in each component with respect to DFS number, and they are partitioning the components. So if you take a strongly connected, an open strongly connected component of GCS, then its first vertex will be its representative, and then some vertex will point to a vertex in the next open component, which has a certain DFS number. And the DFS numbers showing up within S1 are all the numbers between R1 and R2. Okay? So now to see that we are doing something that makes sense here, an important step is to prove that the finished strongly connected components of the component graphs are actually the same as the strongly connected components of the entire graph G. To see that, consider any closed node V and an arbitrary node W in the same strongly connected component of the input graph G as V. Okay? And what we have to show is that W is also closed and it's the same strongly connected component of GC as V is. Now, what does it mean that V and W lie in the same strongly connected component? Yes, there is a path from V to W and a path from W to V, so they form a cycle, not necessarily a simple one. So consider one such cycle C. Okay? By the first invariant, nodes in this cycle are all closed. But by definition of when we close nodes, they are also finished with respect to the terminology of the DFS scheme. But we know that edges out of finished nodes have been explored. Hence, all the edges of this cycle are also in GC. And that's important because that means since we have all the strongly connected components of GC, we also have the cycle considered in our computation. So we have shown that the finished strongly connected components are actually the ones we want to compute. Now, how do we handle the open components? So now we are slowly approaching an actual implementation. We will maintain two stacks that are ordered by the DFS number. One is a small stack that contains only the representatives of open components, and O nodes that contains all open nodes. And remember this partitioning thing. Basically, these things will be on O reps, and this chain here will be on O nodes. So now we can actually start explaining the implementation of strongly connected components in terms of our DFS scheme. So in initialization, we are declaring this component array that will hold the output. And we declare the two stacks, O reps and O nodes, and initialize them to be the empty sequence. And it's easy to verify that all the invariants are satisfied because basically they are easily true because the invariants affect open and closed nodes, but there are no open and closed nodes, right? So they're trivially true. When we encounter a root node, it will be a representative of a new component. So we push it to OREPS, and since it's only in O node, a node, we also push it to O nodes. And actually, in that situation, the set containing just S is the only open component. And yeah, all invariants remain valid, so there is not much to show. When we traverse a tree edge, we will push the newly reached node W on OREPS and O nodes. And that basically opens up a new open component containing only W. It has a DFS number larger than all the others. And it's again easy to see that all the invariants remain valid. So basically, there's a rich set of exercises you can do that whenever I claim that all invariants remain valid, there can be an exercise for each of the invariant to show that in a more detailed and formal way. So the more interesting case is if we traverse a non-tree edge, then we have to distinguish two cases. If the reached node W is not in O nodes, then it's basically a cross edge. So it will be an edge going somewhere here to something that's already finished. And we know that this cannot be anything interesting because in particular it cannot close a cycle. If W is in O nodes, what does that mean? So we explore this edge here, right? It reaches some open node W, which is in some strongly connected component SI of the component graph, which means that there is some path from W to all the nodes here, in particular also back to the representative of Si, Ri. But that means we are closing a cycle, namely the cycle Ri, Rk, then there's a path to V, back to W, and then to Ri. So all these components Ri through Si through Sk now collapse to a single new component. We can very easily collapse this by simply popping nodes from O-reps, namely all these representatives. So we take away the representative state of Rk, Rk minus 1, and so on, except for Ri. And that basically means that only this is a remaining representative and all the other things remain on O nodes and now belong to this new single strongly connected component. Another thing you might want to think about is how to implement this test here efficiently. You basically want to do that in constant time. Then, finally, the backtrack operation is perhaps the most interesting one, because now we have to convert this very intricate, implicit representation of open strongly connected components to a representation that we actually want for the output. Namely, we have to record data in this component array. So, backtrack could be anywhere within a strongly connected components, and we don't have to do anything if we are not backtracking from a representative. And since we are doing DFS, if we are backtracking from a representative, it will always be the representative on top of the OREPS stack. Okay, and what we are doing is basically we are finishing this component. Since it's no longer a representative of an open component, we pop it from the OREPS stack. And we also have to pop all the nodes from the O nodes stack and record the component information in the components array. So we repeat popping nodes from the stack until we have popped V itself, and then we are done. And what do we do to record things? Well, V is a representative of this formerly open component. Now it's a representative of the newly closed component. So we simply assign V to all the component entries of the for all the vertices in this component. So, and now there is really a little bit more to show. So we will now take the time to prove for all the invariants that they remain valid. So perhaps the most complicated one to prove is invariant one. Edges from closed nodes lead to closed nodes. So we have to prove that for all the vertices in SK that is now finished. So consider any node in this component. So we are closing all the nodes in the component, so edges within the component are no problem. There may be edges going to another closed component. That's basically cross edge in DFS terminology. They are also not a problem because these components are also closed. And now, could there be edges to unreached nodes? No, that's not possible, because we have explored all edges out of nodes in here. And if there would be such an edge, it would have been included in this stack and would now be part of this component, actually. Similarly, there cannot be an edge backward to a previous open component, because then these components would have been collapsed to a single one. So invariant one is fine. Invariant 2 says open components form a path in the Schranken component graph. That's okay. We are just removing the one open component from the end of this path, right? And similarly, this partitioning property is the same. We are just removing one component, but otherwise nothing is a problem. So let's look at an example. So we look at this graph with vertices A through K, and yeah, the edges you see here. And we will use extensive encoding with grayscales to see what is what. So the gray edges are unexplored edges, the black ones are explored ones. The hollow circles are unmarked nodes. Gray circles and squares are marked, and black ones are finished. And strongly connected components are put together by some rounded rectangles, so generalizations of this. And if they are closed, they are grayed out. Representative nodes are squares and the others are circles. So the first operation in the DFS scheme, it first initializes everything. That's not so interesting. Then it goes through the vertices and checks whether they are marked. Since nothing is marked, it immediately gets stuck at A and executes a root operation on vertex A, which basically makes it so A becomes an open component represented by A, so it's a trivial one, it contains only that node. Then it will traverse the tree edge AB, and in doing that it will push B on the OREPS and O node stack, opening up a new open component, again a trivial one. Same thing for the tree edge from B to C. So we have so far here a chain of three trivial open components. So the next step will be to traverse the edge, this one, CA. So this closes a cycle between open components and puts them all together. And B and C will lose their representative feature. And now A represents this single open component. So next, we are here on this node C, right? There are no further outgoing edges, so we backtrack on this. And similarly, then backtrack on the edge AB also, which means we are finishing these two nodes. And when we finally backtrack on the representative here, which in that case was a root node, so it's backtrack AA, we are also finishing that node, and then we also finish this strongly connected component of the input graph. So next, we scan for further unmarked nodes. The first one found is D. And now again, we are traversing three tree edges, pushing subsequently the newly reached nodes on our stacks with trivial, strongly connected components. Then we are here, right? There are no further outgoing edges of G. So we are backtracking on edge FG. And that finishes this trivial component. We see G is in a strongly connected component of the output graph in itself. Same is true for node F. Next, from E, there are further unexplored edges. So we look at this edge, which then actually pushes a new open component here. And then there's another edge, HI, traversed. So what we have now is that our stack represents these four open components. And it doesn't matter that in the DFS numbering there's basically a hole here because there are two finished components in between. They don't affect us here for the further processing. So we had this situation. Now, there's an edge IE that closes a cycle, basically collapsing these three connected components to a single one. Okay? Then we find a new tree edge pushing two further components on our stacks. And finally, traversing this edge, KD collapses these four components, this one, this one, this one, and this one, to a single big strongly connected component. Then come a number of backtrack operations. What is it? JK over this one, then IJ over this one, HI over this one, EH over this one, DE over this one, and finally this backtrack DD thing, finalizing this component. And yes, then the DFS algorithm looks for further unmarked nodes. There are none, so the algorithm terminates. So what have you learned in looking at this algorithm for strongly connected components? We have seen a simple, or maybe not so simple, instantiation of the DFS template that has a non-trivial correctness proof. So, well, why do I say it's simple? Let's go back to this code, right? Let's maybe count pseudocode lines. For init, we have three lines. For root, two makes five. Traverse tree edge is two, makes seven lines. 8, 9 for non-tree edge. 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15 lines of pseudocode give us a strongly connected component algorithm. I think that's quite simple, right? But to understand why it works required us to do some work, which is, I think, interesting to see that non-trivial correctness proofs can be helpful. The running time is linear, basically because DFS needs linear time. And the only non-constant time operations in our pseudocodes, let's have a look at them. When backtracking, we pop nodes from these stacks, but every node is popped only once, so that's cost order n at most. And similarly, in non-tree, traverse non-tree edge, we are popping representatives, same thing, right? And maybe what's interesting is that this algorithm does a single traversal of the graph, which makes it a fairly efficient algorithm. So other textbooks use an algorithm that uses two DFS traversals of the graph. They probably contain a few more pseudocode lines, but they are somehow perhaps slightly easier to understand, but in practice they are not as efficient, right? And if you want to know about further improvements in the efficiency of strongly connected component algorithms, perhaps look at this technical report, because it investigates a number of, yeah, maybe dirty tricks, how you can streamline the various tests and updates that have to be done here. So what is the data we're maintaining? We're maintaining a DFS num, a finishing time, node marks. We have to find out whether something is open or not. And we have the OREPs and ONODE stacks. And basically the observation in this paper is that some of these arrays can be, we can get rid of them by deriving the necessary information from the values of of these arrays. But that has surprisingly big effects on running time, something like a factor 2 to 3. So basically the basic thing here is already twice as fast as the two-pass algorithm, and this makes it another 2 or 3 times faster, which is perhaps interesting because strongly connected components are needed in many other graph algorithms. So another reason to look at strongly connected components is that they are just an example of a family of DFS-based algorithms that can do other graph analysis tasks. For example, splitting an undirected graph into two connected components turns out to be a rather similar problem. So these are components that remain connected when removing a single node, and the partitioning are with respect to edges. So for example, in this thing here, these four red edges form a two connected component, as do these blue edges. Because regardless what you remove here, the remaining nodes remain connected. You can actually even do the same thing for three connected components. And actually related to this, planarity testing. So you can test whether a graph can be drawn in the plane. And you can even, if it's planar, derive a way to draw it on the plane. So that's called an embedding of planar graph. So actually it's what you compute there is a combinatorial representation that then allows you to perform a planar drawing of the graph. So this is very crucial for many of the graph algorithms for planar graphs. There's actually a special lecture on planar graphs by the group of Dorothea Wagner. So that brings us to the end of the section on DFS. And next week we will talk about much more advanced and complicated graph algorithms, namely for computing maximum flows. And from that we will derive related algorithms for computing matchings in graphs. Thank you very much.